this moment or any moment, we're at the edge of creation. So we may be dreaming up something that's coming, but we're not conscious of it. I mean, the world was not conscious of dreaming it, or I'm not conscious of the next thing. And yet you say we're actively creating it, but we're not consciously actively creating it. It's the unconscious. Well,
that's why I think about a dream. When I say this is a dream, the dream is a manifestation. It's an unmediated manifestation of the unconscious. Yeah, so to the extent we're unconscious, we are literally dreaming up the waking dream in a way where we either get absorbed in it, and then we're just like, you know, we're lost in samsara, we're in cyclic existence, you know, endless suffering. Or, you know, if we have that realization of, oh yeah, well, wait a second, this is a dream. This is like my unconscious getting reflected back to me. Just like at night, we have dreams. Dreams compensate a one-sidedness. You know, and then as soon as we get the message, then the dream changes, because it doesn't have to, like, you know, actually, you know, sort of embody that reflection anymore. So then it itself changes relative to our realization.
How do we ever get ahead of the curve or become conscious of what doesn't have to, like, hit us in the face? You know, is there a way to be so present?
Yeah. And that's another great question. I just really appreciating your questions, Alan, because, you know, for me, I just know for me, since this pandemic has really gotten, you know, whatever, activated, I just felt so, you know, kind of on fire in a way, like, interesting, the earth is on fire. And one of the things that I've been doing, you know, not only just creatively writing, you know, just stuff pouring out of me every day, like a lot of the stuff we're talking about, but in my spiritual practice, just really becoming more familiar, you know, with my nature. And that nature is like a mirror. It's like space. So instead of being, you know, kind of identified with the thoughts, or or just like reacting to my thoughts or being conditioned by my thoughts, I'm just more and more establishing myself in the viewpoint of the true nature, which is just like, oh, wow. My nature, my authentic nature is like space. My authentic nature is like a mirror. And all of the body sensations, the thoughts, the feelings, the sounds, all phenomena are just momentary displays of my nature. And when I recognize that, whatever's happening, which would have caught me in, you know, in my complexes or in identification, now actually even stimulates my awakening even deeper, so I even more am able. So it's what spiritual practice is. I'm describing spiritual practice. You just really recognize your true nature, which is like space, which is like that mirror, which is always the same. It's always available, and it's free. Just like a mirror is never tainted or stained by any reflections, you just more and more recognize that. We always have that. We just haven't recognized it. And once you recognize it, that's to really become lucid. And then you destabilize that recognition. And then everything that arises moment by moment, inner and outer, just gets liberated into that particular state. That's spiritual practice. So that, I think, if we don't have that foundation, then it's easy to get thrown off balance by what's happening.
Right. So I think that was the answer to the question I asked, is how do you get ahead of the curve, in a sense? And you're saying, go within, look at your nature. Look at your habits, your tendencies, your where you may go unconscious. So if you aware of the unconscious, it doesn't have to come back and like come at you, you know, in an outward way. When you know yourself, then
yeah, and I want to say too. And then the other, you know, that's like the foundation. And then I can't say enough about the profundity of being creative, because, you know, I just want to, there's a word, the daimonic. And the daimonic is a transpersonal archetypal energy that can literally take over the ego, and then we become its instruments. Now, the daimonic.
The
daimonic has to do exactly with the daimon. And the daimon is the inner voice and the guiding spirit and the genius, and it helps us find our calling and our vocation. All of that etymologically is related to the daimon, right? And angel, that's another way of saying it. And but if we don't get into conscious relationship with that daimon and then, you know, find our genius and get in touch with our, you know, our guiding spirit and our inner voice and find our vocation and our mission. If we don't do that, and if we don't get into conscious relationship with that diamond, it constellates negatively and becomes a demon. And that's Wetiko. Okay. So what I'm saying is that encoded in the creative and encoded in that demon, encoded in the daimon, is the creative spirit. So what I'm basically saying is that if we don't consciously express our creative spirit, it turns into a demon. That's Wetiko, because the greatest poison in the human psyche is unexpressed creativity.
Okay. Yes, because that's our destiny. We can't, this is my philosophy. We came here to create, to make known the unknown, to have the universe come through us and express.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And that's where, you know, the idea of we're created in the image of God. That's what, from my point of view, that's what it's talking about.
As creator, we are the creator.
We are created by God, but we're also creative beings. And that's the evolutionary step, you know, that we actually, like I keep on saying, we're actually being demanded. We are participating in our own evolution, or we're going to be like we're doing, like we've been doing, you know, creating collective suicide as a species. Right. But like, so here we're being demanded to, like, you know, tap into, to see and to actualize and to implement the creative genius, the part of us that is the creator. We've been creating all along.
Right.
Every moment of our lives, we've been creating our experience. Every moment, how we interpret and place meaning on our experience. That's what quantum physics, like, showed. The way they set up the experiments, the questions they asked, how they interpreted the data, that all determined the answers they got back, right? That maps onto, yeah, we, how we interpret moment by moment our experience and place meaning on it, and the questions we ask, that's like actually influencing how our very experience shows up. And we're the ones having the experience. We're the ones creating our experience of the world. So when you see that, oh my God, that's what it's all about, is to tap into that creativity that we've been using all the time anyway, but unconsciously, in a way that's killing us, and to actually plug into it consciously in a way that's serving who we're discovering ourselves to be, which is that we're not different.
Serving who we're supposed to, and the greater humanity. I'm writing a book, something called The Artist's Role in Creating New Realities. And we incarnated to be expressive, creative beings. That's the purpose of this incarnation, I feel, is to serve the creative spirit as it flows through us and as it's expressed. And in this way, we uplift the totality of humanity with our creativity, and everyone's doing that.
We then, by us actually participating in, becoming a vessel, becoming an instrument for that incarnating, you know, Godhead, the creativity of that Godhead, then God, you know, actually can incarnate through us. We ourselves are birthing God through us, offering ourselves as instruments for the creative spirit.
I totally agree. I've been writing about this for a long time. And I think when we're all creators, we're going to have that transform society. There's a dialogue of Plato about Socrates meeting a poet. You know that one called Ion, the Ion dialogue, I-O-N? And he says—
Well, there's that collective work in Jung, Ion, but anyways.
Well, from Plato, though, going back to Plato and Socrates, Socrates meets this poet, this rhapsoder, which recites the poetry of Homer, and he won all these awards. And Socrates says to him, "Do you know why you're so great?" And he goes, "Yes, it's because I can feel the power and do all this and, you know, put my energy in." And Socrates goes, "No, that's not what makes your rhapsody so great. It's because you're not there when it happens. The gods come through you."
Any artist of whatever medium, when you get out of your own way and just allow whatever's wanting to come through you to come through, you just become an instrument.
Exactly. You know? This is what, imagine everyone on the planet found their creative input, whether it was music or dancing or storytelling or art or whatever. That is that's the world we're supposed to be living in. That's what I call the flowering of humanity. That's our destiny.
Exactly. And it doesn't even make a difference what medium it is. Even if we're washing dishes creatively, that could be our art form.
What you know, just it is to bring through the spirit. Yes.
Right. So, no, totally.
I think now we're in this sacred time now, these 2 weeks of, or a month or months of sheltering, where we can go in and find out what is our creative gifts. And when you find that, it doesn't matter if you're inside all day, because that's what you're doing. For me, this is a great opportunity to catch up on all the great projects I want to do.
Right. And the thing is that, you know, going back to the dream, because that's fundamental, is that when you recognize this as the dream, one of the ways of articulating that is you recognize that the outer world is reflecting what's happening inside of us. And it's interesting because Wetiko is a psycho-spiritual disease of the soul that has the magic power of somehow extending itself out into the world and configuring events so as to reflect the state of the psyche that's under its thrall. So what I'm pointing at is you recognize that what you're experiencing in the outer world is actually reflecting the state inside of your psyche, you know, that's when you're beginning to recognize the dreamlike nature. Now, the thing which is interesting in the Gospel of Thomas, in the apocryphal text, Christ says, you enter the kingdom when you make the inner as the outer. That's exactly what he's pointing at, you know? So there are three ways of dispelling Wetiko. You know, one is to recognize the dreamlike nature, because when you recognize the dreamlike nature, you're seeing through the illusion of the separate self, and then Wetiko has no power over you. The other is to see the through the separate self. That's the second one. And the third is to see the non-local field that we're contained in, and expressions of a non-local field that is a higher dimension in which everything is interconnected. There's just a state of wholeness. There's no separation. And they're all those three ways, the seeing the dreams, seeing through the separate self, and seeing the non-local field. They're like three aspects of the same jewel. It's the same realization, just expressed differently. And when you stabilize that, then that's when you have the lucidity. And of course, the practice is to just stabilize that, you know, and elongate that until it's all throughout your day. And, you know, and then connecting with other people who are doing that, all bets are off, because quantum physics, one of the most mind-blowing things about quantum physics, it blows away what we think of as being impossible. That's showing us so much, because if we have all the evidence we need to feel despair and pessimism and depressed, hopeless, but if we're holding that viewpoint of pessimism, then we're actually colluding with the very darkness and the very evil that's playing out. But, you know, when you see the dreamlike nature and discover, oh my God, you know, I could actually, you know, hold the vision that this is going to be the catalyst for humanity awakening, you know, and going through that portal into, you know, like a more grace-filled dream. And even though somebody might say, well, that's highly ridiculously unlikely, I don't believe that, but quantum physics says, but it's possible. And if you're not envisioning that, then what are you thinking?
Well, let's do that. I was going to ask you, what do you think would be the best outcome of the dream, or to wake up, but to hold this as the portal to the new humanity?
Yeah. Well, but that answer, it's not written in stone. We're literally dreaming the dream right now. We're creating. So let's like start dreaming into that. Let's imagine into that. Let's co-create that. And that's what I'm talking about. When you bring people who are switched on, when you bring, like, you know, these awakened dreamers, these creative artists, these people who are spiritually emerging, who are just not, they're just discovering our nature. And our nature is that we're interdependent, that there is no such thing as the separate self. That's me disease. That's Wetiko. That's the illusion. That's the optical delusion of consciousness that Einstein said we have to make the greatest task of humanity, is to see through that, the illusion of the separate self. That's the gift of the coronavirus. And then when you see that, you connect with other people who are seeing it, that's where things, you know, all bets are off, because then we can really change the dream, the waking dream. And that's just not woo-woo, new age, like magical thinking. That's what's being offered to us.
That is what's being offered to us right now. We are moving through a portal in humanity that's never been seen before. We've never had the opportunity to do this. Yeah, there were viruses and pandemics in the past, but we've never been so connected as we are now, to move through this into a new dream that could be of service for all, that each part of our dream body could be happy or help.
The thing is that quantum physics is saying this universe is not determinant. Right. We can't predict the future. It doesn't, you know, we are literally creating it moment by moment. And, you know, that's what I mean, that this is being offered to us and there is a quantum like superposition of states. It's both encoded in what's happening in the coronavirus pandemic. It's like the greatest nightmare. That's a complete catastrophe. That's going to create incredible suffering. Or, you know, it's a lucidity stimulator. It actually can stimulate us to recognize we're dreaming, and how it manifests depends on how we dream it. And not just one person. One person can have that realization, but there are like so many other, you know, 7.5 billion other humans and other all sentient beings.
How should we dream it? I mean, not that there's a should, but how we dream it. I'm not saying you have the answer, but how should we dream? I think I've probably asked you this. How should we dream it?
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, that's a question that no one outside of ourselves, there's no authority. So we have to find that, you know, the inner guidance, that's the daimon, you know, and that's the genius. And that's what this is all about, you know. And so absolutely, we, you know, not figure it out with our mind, that gets revealed. Because remember, this is a revelation. So it's like we're being given everything we need. We just have to have open eyes and recognize it. And then we're literally shown moment by moment. It's like, for example, when I give lectures, I have no idea what I'm ever going to say. I don't, you know, prepare, or this interview, I didn't prepare. I just, you know, did my thing today, whatever, you know, writing a new article. But I've learned to trust that if I just let go in the moment, that whatever I need to say, it's going to be given to me in the moment, you know. And yet a number of years ago, I would start to prepare and memorize stuff. And those talks or interviews would go horribly.
Right. So how do we dream? I'm not asking for the answer, but I know what you're saying. How are you going to dream it?
We each have our role. We each have our role to play.
Right. I'm not logically figuring it out, but I'm just.
Yeah. Right. No, it's a perfect question. I mean, I appreciate it because, you know, feel free to ask that 100 more times.
I'm not asking you for an answer. I wouldn't want you to tell me. I mean, that would spoil it, but I'm just asking.
Right, exactly. But what it is, we each have a particular role in the dream. Like my role, I'm happy to be doing like an interview like this or giving talks or writing articles and books. That's my, and then I have groups and I, you know, hang out with people, and that's my role. And it's the very role that's helping me to deepen my lucidity and to heal myself, you know? But we each have to figure out what is their unique gift. You know, we all have a particular creative gift, and it could just be being a good father or mother or husband or whatever. It doesn't have to look in any sort of noble way. Like we have these visions of, oh, I'm going to be the Messiah and change the world. The idea is we all are the Messiah. That's what I was saying, that the Messiah, the self, God is not incarnating 2,000 years ago through one human being like he did. He's incarnating through all of humanity, but he's incarnating through our unconscious, which means that, you know, the shadow is going to become illumined. And that's where we either then act it out, or what I'm pointing out is that the coronavirus, because it's becoming physical, it's the physical emanation of the higher dimensional Wetiko virus. From the dreaming point of view, that's a gift. Something is being offered to us. Something is being shown to us. And the medium through which, you know, we understand it is consciousness. We have to recognize what is being offered to us, what's being revealed to us, and that changes everything.
Isn't it a miracle in this time that something is concretely being offered to us as a manifestation of the Wetiko, of the collective human?
It's a miracle. I mean, it's totally a miracle, and it's totally ordinary. It's the way dreaming works. Now, if I could just go back to one thing, because I had written an article a month ago about, you know, that we're all shamans in training. And a shaman, that's a wounded healer, right? And I identify not so much with the shaman, even though the shaman archetype is activated in all of us in the collective unconscious, but I identify as a wounded healer because what precipitated and catalyzed my awakening was this profound wounding. And that catapulted me into a spiritual awakening, but I still feel the wound, but I carry it differently. I don't experience it as problematic. I don't identify with it, but the wound becomes the doorway for my deeper gifts to come through. And that's the archetype of the shaman, of the wounded healer. But the thing that I wrote the article about that is so relevant for right now and is so interesting, the figure of the shaman, what they do when they work with someone, they will literally, because they're so empathic, they will literally take on the illness of the person they're working with and become ill themselves. But then they're able, based on their connection to their wholeness, to metabolize the illness and bring themselves back to health. And that non-locally, energetically heals the client. And I'm basically saying we're in that role. The shamanic archetype is activated in the collective psyche. And what I just described, we've all been sickened by the collective madness that's in the universe that we've been dreaming up, you know, all of us. We ourselves have been, you know, it's crazy making. We've been sickened by it. You know, we all feel out of balance or, you know, like you were describing, not in touch with nature, with ourselves. And yet the shaman archetype is that to the extent we're in touch with our wholeness, we're able to like assimilate that sickness and metabolize it in a way that not only brings us back to health, but then we even have more power or lucidity or love or compassion than we did previously. And we're all being cast in that role of being shamans in training, of like assimilating the sickness in the field. And then when we do that, then we just radiate and transmit, you know, in whatever way we do creatively, you know, our light, you know, we let our light shine, so to speak. And that actually, you know, sunlight's the best disinfectant. Interesting, you know?
No, that's beautiful. Thank you. And so letting in the light, you're right. That is the best disinfectant. And so what I get from all this, I mean, you said a lot and it's all great because you're so in touch with this collective psyche that has now manifested itself. You've been preparing for 40 years for this analysis. And so I get you're saying, as we get in touch with this creative part of us, that the daemon that wants to express, we will add to this way through this portal. We will add our creative nature to the collective that's finding its way through uncertainty to a new world. This is a new world. This is a new time, and it's
It's like we're all cells in a greater organism, you know,
and we're mutating. This is a mutation.
Well, the thing that's so great that you say that, because, you know, typically we want to come up with like a vaccine or an antidote, you know, and then the virus mutates to sort of resist our attempts to heal it. But the thing with this, and, you know, the thing with this virus, it's forcing us to mutate, you know, it's catalyzing our evolution. And that's mind-blowing. That's so mind-blowingly profound. And so, yeah, if we can just, you know, the real danger is to get, you know, hooked and caught by the fear. Because then when that's the energy that we're embodying and we're like transmitting, then we're part of the problem. You know, then we're sick in need of being of help. But if we actually, yeah, it's natural to feel afraid at certain points, but then not to identify with it, you know, not to be caught by it, and then to recognize the dreamlike nature, or to get creative, or to get in touch with yourself, they're all saying the same thing in different ways. Then we're actually, you know, embodiments. Then we're in a way anti-psychotic agents, you know, and we then are like the T cells in the body politic that's healing, you know, the mind cancer of Wetiko.
Because I do see this as a transformational agent for the culture. What's your vision of a world without self-sabotage?
When I wrote my book on Wetiko, I mean, it really spoke to a lot of people and helped a lot of people, but some people who are just overly identified with the light, you know, didn't even, you know, bookstores didn't even want to carry it. People didn't even want to have the book in their house.
Because there was too much darkness in it. Is that it?
Right. It was seemingly talking about evil, right? And meanwhile, I'm trying to illumine evil to take away its power over us, because it only has power over us to the extent that we turn a blind eye and avoid it. So I point out that, yeah, we don't want to avoid, you know, the darkness, but we don't want to become overly fascinated by it. There are people who do that, And then we're feeding it, and then, you know, then it's contagious, and then we unwittingly become an instrument to act it out. But what we do want to do, and this is important, is to see Wetiko or the darkness or evil and see how it acts itself out, see how it operates in the world, through the non-local field, and within our minds, through our unconscious reactions. And once you see that, then we're sovereign beings. Right. We can choose how we want to place our attention. Then we can invest our attention in creating the world we want to live in.
And keeping in touch with that. I mean, I love that quote by Thomas Jefferson, who said, "The price of freedom is constant vigilance." So that's the spiritual practice.
Being mindful. Exactly. It's cultivate that mindfulness. Right. And then when we invest our attention in creating the world we want to live in, well, the world I want to live in, which I've been actively imagining for decades, is where we all wake up. Because the idea of the bodhisattva, they're about to enter nirvana, you know, they become enlightened, and then they look back and they see all their suffering fellow brothers and sisters, and they realize, oh my God, these are parts of me. They're not separate. They are me that you know, are still under the illusion. So they make the bodhisattva vow to come back, you know, into this world to help other people to wake up. And then they don't enter nirvana until everyone else enters first. Because who is everyone? But just, we're all cells in a greater body. We all depend on each other. We're interconnected. We're one. We're literally one. And so, yeah, that's the vision of like that I'm having, is that, okay, if there's no Wetiko, and if we all really get it, including everyone, you know, in the 1%, the 99%, the people controlling the levers of power, everyone gets it. And we realize we're in this soup together. It's being cooked for us. We're all in this together. We depend on each other, and we're actually not separate. That's like, and you know, keep in mind the energetic expression of that realization is compassion, you know? And so then Om Mani Padme Hum, the mantra of compassion, just like, you know, just actually visualizing a universe where that's the ruler, where that's the pervasive, that's the atmosphere in which we all live, is realizing that, and it's pervading the energy of compassion, is pervading throughout the entire field. That's the vision, that's the dream. When I become lucid in my dreams at night, that's what I do. You know, when it first happened, I didn't even do, it just came through me. Just, I started chanting Om Mani Padme Hum and radiating out this incredible love and compassion for the entire universe, because I was realizing it was me. That's what lucidity is. And that's just what happens every time, not only in my night dreams, but that's my practice. That's like part of my practice that I do all throughout the day. It's just, people want to wake up, cultivate compassion. Because in Buddhism, they say true awakening is always the co-joining of two factors, of emptiness, that's lucidity, and compassion. Om Mani Padme Hum, the mantra of compassion. So if you want to wake up in the dream, it's in a way very simple. Just work on your own, on opening your own heart, having what His Holiness Dalai Lama calls the good heart, being filled with bodhicitta, the heart and the mind of awakening, where you're actually wanting the best interest of everyone.
Well, thank you, Paul. This is beautiful. I think we got the first lesson as a planetary consciousness, that we are all connected. So the Wetiko virus has infected us, to know that that is true. It's obvious, it's in the news, it's on every, you know, media outlet. The planet, we are, you can't avoid it now, that part of the dream.
Think about it like, you know, the coronavirus, it's creating a shock, it's a trauma. It's creating a shock in our system, and it's creating a shock in the system, okay? And so, you know, the whole system has to reconfigure, you know. Well, I mean,
this is the future I hope we're all going to dream through this portal. This is a later manifestation of that dream, to go into action now, because we have no choice.
Yeah. Well, we have a choice, and the choice is to, you know, is completely horrifying. It's like, you know, it's just like death of our species. I mean, and, you know, destruction of the biosphere. And it's like, yeah, so in that sense, we have no choice. I mean, we're really being demanded, you know, to step up and to wake up and to just do our part. You know, my part is just, talking to you right now, or writing my next article, or,
you know. That's all we can do, is what comes to us to do.
The non-local field, which is the whole universe, it's alive, it's sentient, and it synchronistically is expressing itself. That's what I mean when I say the outer is reflecting the inner. So if we're having like an inner process in the group, you know, the outer environment you know, not just in the room, but in the whole world, might at that moment be like picking up what's happening inside of us and manifesting through, you know, a physical event. Right. That's to recognize the dream.
That's what I'm saying. The field is showing us now, and it's showing us through the lens of your work, that the field is telling us there's this knock on the door, wake up. Something new can enter into the system. I think it's just great what you've been doing. So
right, no, totally. And I really appreciate, you know, you're inviting me to come on and talk about it, Ellen, because my dream is that, you know, what we're talking about today, for this to get out, for people to really take this in, because this is the medicine. And this can literally change the entire world if sufficient people, if enough people have this realization and actually embody it and connect with each other, we can literally change the waking dream. And that's evolution. That's what this is all about. So my prayer and vision is that, you know, nothing to do with me, what I'm talking about, the information that's coming through, the perspective that I'm trying to, like, you know, sort of offer to people is so unbelievably helping and helpful. And I just really hope that this becomes the contagion. Almost every day now, I'm just writing new articles about the coronavirus, you know, this way of seeing it, that's really, I think, helping people. And yeah, they're gonna be posted too, or they are posted.
Thank you. I've been talking to Paul Levy, Awaken in the Dream. I'm Alan Steinfeld for New Realities. Thanks for watching.